part one and we'll review it in part two. So, I hope that you will all come back. If we have enough, then sit, everybody. Okay, so let's just jump into this. Definition of a team. A team is a small number of people with complementary skills who are committed to a common purpose, performance goals, and approach for which they hold themselves mutually accountable. Now, this is a packed definition of a team. So let's kind of dissect it a little bit. What do you see as you look through this definition as key components that stand out to you?
Small group.
All right, it's a small group. And that small group could be anywhere from, let's say, 3 to 15. So, I mean, it's not like a group of 80 to 100 people. That'd be a small congregation. But we're looking at that team for the purpose of other areas. Okay, small group. What else just stood out to you?
Complementary.
All right. What does that mean? Complementary skills.
They complement each other. They don't have to be the same.
Ah, okay. All right. So we can celebrate diversity. We all come with unique strengths. And those strengths can speak into each other's life to the degree that we can submit ourselves to other people's strengths. The submission part is the hard part. That's the hard part. But complementary skills, when we can embrace those skills that others have that we may not have, that enables us to move quite a bit further as a team. Okay, what else?
Common goals.
Common goals, yes. So we actually have that which we want to accomplish. What else?
Committed.
Say that again?
Committed.
Ah, committed. So how would we understand committed?
Commitment.
Yeah, so how would we, what would that mean to us if we were on a team?
Responsible.
Okay, responsible.
You don't give up.
I don't give up.
They're all in together.
Okay.
Show up.
Okay. Do you know that statistically, a person will say, I belong to that church if they attend only 2 times a month. They'll say, that's my church. Committed. Is that what we're talking about? Somebody said show up. Do we mean show up what? Once in a while? Every time? What?
My parents, that meant every time the doors of the church were open, they were there.
Okay, we're not talking about church, though. We're talking about a team.
Okay.
We're talking about the context of a team. in terms of the commitment work. Is that what you're keying off of? Okay. She said a spiritual and a
physical,
meaning?
Be there. And pray for it when you're not there, and pray for it when you are there.
Thank you. Anything else that stands out?
Mutually accountable.
Mutually accountable. Now, what could that mean in the context of a team?
There's so many things that don't hold any accountability for anymore. Everybody has a vested interest, and you have to do your part, or you know, there should be something that is said or whatever to do.
Okay. Another observation for mutually accountable. How does that ring with somebody else?
Mutually means equally.
Mm-hmm. OK. Okay.
But you're on the same level. There's not one person that is going to hold everybody or hold everybody together. It's not one person doing it.
Okay, so there is a mutuality in this accountability. It's not a one-way, it's a two-way, okay?
And it's equal. It's not someone's above another one.
Okay.
A team is equal.
Contract is no I in team.
A team is equal, okay? No I in team.
Yeah.
All right.
That sounds threatening to me. Mutually accountable.
Okay. What's the threatening piece, the mutually or the accountable?
That's my way. I think it's accountable.
So this definition is taken from this book. It's a good read, The Wisdom of Teams. And it's a definition that you can wrestle with. So let's just go over it one more time. It's a small number of people, complementary skill that we've already talked about. It's not all the same thing. It's different people with different skills can come together. They are committed. They themselves are committed. They are committed, I'm willing, to a common purpose. Somebody said you were talking earlier today about vision. About purpose. There's a goal. There's a reason for the team to exist. There's something that you're doing. There's an approach for which they'll hold themselves mutually accountable. Now, nobody made mention to the word approach. What do you think they're talking about in that definition? Say that again.
A plan.
A plan. Okay. Okay.
Timeline.
Timeline.
And I'm going to do this in a certain amount of time.
Could be also the way they're going to do it. How we're going to do this. How we're going to do it. All right. Building teams is not the same as team building. It is not a project, it's a process, and it demands a lot of practice. These slides that you see are going to be on your handout. It is also not a program, but it's rather a philosophy of ministries. And team, like any living thing, needs a climate that is conducive to growth. My wife, Marcia, who's here today too, Martian and I met at Asbury College down in Kentucky. And it took us a couple of years of knowing each other before we fell in love. And 2 years after that, we got married. We served in the Alliance Church out in Cheyenne, Wyoming. And then we went overseas as international workers for 24 years. Our first two terms overseas, we were assigned to what we would call a mission station. It was an area, and our first term was, we lived on this island called Timor, but we were responsible for leadership development, evangelism, theological education on 5 islands that were in our area. So we lived on the Kupang station. We were the only people there. Our closest colleagues were 2 hours by plane to the next station. We did this for 2 terms. We were on that island, then we moved to the island of Java. We lived in the central part of the island for our second term. Again, we were put on the station of Ungara. The philosophy was, if you have a worker, you place them there, place them there, place them there. We're going to cover 1, 1, 1. Our third term, we were asked to join with others to initiate a brand new work. It was to reach out to a segment was a people group who were Muslim in their religious background. But we had not, as a mission, ever engaged them intentionally with the good news of Jesus Christ. So there was Marcia and myself, another couple, a third couple from Canada, and a single woman. We were selected as a team by others, and we were put together with the purpose of developing a strategy that would engage this people group. That experience changed our lives forever on how to do ministry. We went from Dave and Marcia, develop, strategize, execute, evaluate. Two, we work with others to do the same thing. It was a dramatic change in orientation in how to get something done. The benefits of developing higher levels of teamwork must be felt and visible on the bottom line. If you don't see tangible ministry results over time, it's highly unlikely you will invest the time needed to develop a more effective team. So when we use the word team, as trendy as it may sound, as for some it's an inviting team. For others, it's an inhibited, it's a word that threatens. Because of the reality of working, I may have to work with somebody I don't like. But the fact is that working together should produce better results. Because that's why you're going to invest in it. I want to unpack, though, a bit more of that idea. The purpose of the team is to accomplish an objective at an exceptional level. So in other words, working together as a team is going to yield results that are better than individual effort. Teamwork is not an end in itself, but it's rather that means to an end. Ultimately, the success of team building will be judged by were we able to complete that task. Now, before this sounds a little too... before this may come across a little too much of a business approach. Did we sell the product? Did it get bought? Let's unpack this whole thing about teaming and team development. There is a great model that was developed by a guy named Hackman, and this came out probably in the 60s. And there are probably some here today that are quite familiar with it. But when you look at group development, and it's going to transfer into teaming, it is these five stages that Tuckman said actually happen over and over and over again. There is a forming stage. There is a storming stage. There is a norming stage and a performing stage. Finally, there is an adjourning stage. Now, he added that last stage about 10 years later, seeing that teams do have a time when they may conclude. The task is over, the team is dispersed, and you celebrate that. So it's actually worded in a way that has a bit of a ring to it, because you will find that you cannot bypass these stages. You have got to go through them. So there's the forming, the storming, the norming, performing stages. So so let's just get into it and unpack these a little bit. So stage one, the forming stage. This is where a group initially comes together. That team comes together. That forming piece of this stage, it's characterized by nervousness and uncertainty amongst members. That's going to be common. So when you're forming a team and feeling a little uneasy. That is normal, because it's in the formative stages of this team. Extroverted people on that team may assume a leadership role. So in a group, it's not uncommon that an extrovert will kind of get the initial steps in a leadership role. The questions that need to be clarified in the forming stage is, why are we here? What are we doing? What is our goal, and what's our purpose? You move and develop a sense of awareness. So let's drill down just a little bit more, self-awareness. You drill down on that self-awareness, and you are clearly moving toward inclusion. All right. Just take a minute and think about the sphere of influence that you have. So when you say, I'm here and I'm wearing this leadership hat, beside that slide, just quickly write down, why are we here in that area? What are we doing in this area? Just write down, you might just do a bullet point of a couple of words. You may actually have a sentence. What's the goal of what I do? So just take a minute and just jot down some brief answers to those questions. Okay, now I know you're not done, but give me a little bit of feedback. Did those answers just flow, or did you have to pause?
Yeah.
Both.
Flow.
Flow, okay? They flow. Anybody else?
Flow.
It flowed? Good. Good. If they cannot, that's not a problem. But these are questions that are answered in that forming stage. So, when you think of, say you are a department head, or let's say you oversee a particular team, it's critical that you as the leader answer these questions, but not just you. It's critical that your team can answer the same questions. Because going back to our definition of a team, it's that shared ownership of these matters. And when you are trying to do that, it does take time. It does take time. I have been in many churches. I have been in many churches where you could ask somebody that would maybe be a board member or maybe an elder, hey, kind of what, just real quick, what do you do and why? And there's a pause. There's a pause. And it's not to be a punitive thing. It's not to be a put down. But what it does is it gives a little feedback. Because knowing why you're here is absolutely critical. So for us as leaders, for the members of our team to know those answers, why are we here? What do we do? That's critical. Because as we bump it up bigger, you float these questions and they go even to the bigger questions. Our church, why is our church here? What is our purpose? What's our purpose in our community? So those questions will always be surfaced up and down the ladder within our ministries. So these are the key parts in that team forming stage. Observations or feedback on this particular stage of development. Let's look at this one. This is the fun part. This is called storming. And I think they use the word storming not because it just rhymes, but it's nicer than to say fighting and all-out brawling and pulling somebody's hair. That just doesn't sound that good in a seminar. But notice what happens in the storming stage of team development. There are some that compete for positions and roles within the group. So there's some competition that's going on within that. And it's that competing that causes the storming. I don't like you competing for that. Is competing right? Some compete for status. Some compete for control. Some compete for authority. Some compete for influence. There's conflict that happens in the storming stage. It's a testing time for leadership. Nothing's worse than being in charge of a group that's just fighting. I mean, man, that's a tough day for a leader. But it is a part of team development, and you can't bypass it because it's natural. It's the question for us is, though, how do we go through it?
Do you think a facilitator is a good idea in that stage?
Tell me a little bit more about what you're thinking here.
I've been on teams where you have a facilitator who all these things still happen, but your job is to just not let them get out of control, let the weaker people speak and calm down the, you know, really vocal ones, and, you know, just keep order. Let it happen just in an orderly fashion.
So let the storming happen in orderly fashion. Okay. That probably is going to fall on the role of the leader. Yeah, that facilitator, that leader is going to need to know this is what you're going to go through. So as a department head, as a team leader, as a pastor, as an elder, as a board member, this is going to happen. This is going to happen. Disagreements and arguments arise. Wow, this is like terminology. We don't want to talk about it at church. Disagreements and arguments arise. You know, when we were overseas, you always hear stories. And that's maybe safer to use illustrations that are 13,000 miles away. So on this field where Marsha and I worked, they have the team that was called the Field Executive Committee. And they would meet four times a year. Well, remember, these are very independent, very strong-willed people. I mean, they're living in these desolate villages. I mean, they're up rivers, they're hiking, trying to get the gospel out. And so people, they did really well on their own. But when you brought them together, all these strong-willed, independent people, those values were coming out. And they would have a lot of disagreements and arguments. And the story is told of one guy, they're sitting around this table. He actually turned his chair away from the table and faced the wall. He was so mad at what they were deciding in the group. I didn't know that person, but I thought, okay, that was quite an argument that you actually turned and you just faced the wall. I don't know if that was the best approach, but that's what he thought he needed to do. Out of the storming stage, roles are eventually allocated. The initial leaders may not survive this period. It is the most uncomfortable phase for a team. It's the most uncomfortable phase. So here you've got here you have a developmental phase that all teams go through, and it's the most uncomfortable. The caution is, we're going to be tempted to ease the uncomfortableness. Oh, I'm just not going to say anything. Oh, just let it be. Oh, they're just that way. I mean, you can hear the comments that will go on because it is uncomfortable. When we're storming, what do we do with it? I mean, what do we do if we're a group of elders and we're storming? We shouldn't be storming. Maybe the thought, or this isn't right. But this is a stage that all groups are going to go through. At various levels, they're going to experience this. Some thoughts about the storming stage. How many have experienced that on a team? Okay, so there should be some reactions to thoughts on this stage then. What are some observations on this storming stage?
A lot of times the loudest person ends up getting what they want if the group doesn't speak up. Because they're the most vocal, the loudest, the longest.
Okay, so there can be an intimidating factor.
Yeah.
Okay? Okay? Somebody else? Other observations out of the storming stage?
Can the team actually just break up if the storming phase is bad enough? Can it be the end of the team?
Yeah, it could actually knock you out. I mean, some teams don't survive this because they're unaware of it. Like, why are we at each other? Like, they're just so caught off guard. Like, why am I having such strong feeling over this? You know, why do I feel like I can't express what I think?
Do people, they try to spiritualize that then? If I'm a Christian and love the Lord, we shouldn't be arguing and fighting like this.
Sure, sure.
Sometimes it's okay to disagree. And when you leave, sometimes you have to recognize that. I've actually had to be in a meeting one time where we stopped, we agreed that we were disagreeing, and we went to prayer.
Good. Good. Now, why did you qualify your statement? You qualified it by saying sometimes.
Sometimes you're in a situation where the loudest person's winning.
Okay. So, in other words, it may not be at that point the best time to deal with that.
That's right.
That's surfacing. Okay. Okay.
If you've got the authority established when this is set up, whoever the leader is, and he's been trained to recognize what's going on, there's skills for kind of managing that, which may work or may not, depending on the people on the team.
Can you manage this, or do you need to solve this? It's kind of a both and, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because if I've got to get through this, I've got to both manage how it's happening, but also solve it so we can move on. Because if you're not careful, in other words, if there is not something that guides you, you're going to create so much pain here that you just can't move on. So if these stages of competition, or if this conflicts that come up, or if these disagreements that emerge, if we don't have a pathway to go through those, we're just going to end up hurting each other. And I bet you that we could find a commonality in this group where we all have been hurt in one of these types of settings. So we know the potential downside. That's where I like that definition of team, where it talks about we are going to agree to an approach, how we're going to do this teaming. So when I express my opinion, it's not just all things barred. No, I'm going to still speak with dignity. I'm going to speak with respect. To know that, do you know that when you make a point, you just power up and you lean in and you just dominate that and you cut people off when they disagree? I mean, that's that awareness piece. So how do we learn that? How do we grow? It happens in this forming stage. It is a stage in the development of a body which Jesus redeems. He redeems it if we remain submitted to himself and to each other. We come back to that mutual accountability. That mutual accountability. This is not so unlike a marriage. I mean, it's not so unlike a marriage. But it's important that we get this is a developmental stage in the formation of a team. Now, maybe after this stage, nobody wants to form a team. Like, who wants to go through this? But like I said, for myself, once I know the joy of team ministry, I do not want to go back to anything else. Because I want to be able to invest myself in other people and reproduce what the Lord's put passion in my heart into others and raise up another generation. All right, the third stage, the norming stage. When a team begins to normalize itself, group identity takes shape. What behaviors and contributions are acceptable and are normalized in the group are now clear. So coming out of that storming stage, we realize that, no, there are some things that are not acceptable. There are some things that are not right. We will not be able to do our task as a group if we keep talking this way or if we keep treating each other this way. We just won't get the job done. What's frowned upon, what's not tolerated. Implicit and explicit group norms. Structure begins to be formed. In a norming stage, a group can readily slip back into storming if they're not aware of it, because that storming stage is always present. Cooperation is very clear, and a cohesion now has happened. So you realize when you have come out of that storming stage, because something has changed. You are stronger. You are more unified. You are committed more to each other. You have been through deep waters, and you're still together. Anybody that's gone through troubles in their marriage knows that on the other side you're a stronger couple because of what you've come through. But we do know, going through that storming stage, that wounds can be caused that are just not easily forgotten. So when our team was formed, here we had three couples and a single woman. We had two American couples. We had one Canadian couple. We had one single Chinese-Canadian woman. Now, right away, you can see that we all do not have shared views. Some views are, I mean, while we're all North Americans, some are from the United States and some are from the Great White North. And there's different perspectives. We also realize that some of us are married, some are not. Well, there's another set of perspectives that I wasn't aware of. There are some things that as a married person we were going to wrestle with. That single person wasn't. But there were some challenges that single woman faced. I had no idea. So one of the activities that we set upon was to establish some core values. What is important to us as a team? Because what came out of that storming stage is that, why are we getting so excited, so engaged over issues that we both agree on? Why were we getting very emphatic in our statements when we're talking about evangelism? And one person says, it's about lifestyle evangelism. And somebody else says, no, it's about proclamation. We've got to be out speaking on the corner of the street. And we're arguing this stuff out. It started to emerge in that storming stage that a lot of conflicts were coming out of differing values that we each came with. And those values, as they surface as to what's important to us, both as an individual and as a team, as those values were surfaced, it brought so much understanding. I thought somebody was arguing against me, and I realized there was a different value that was brought in. We actually both agreed on the big subject. Where the disagreement came was in how we did it. Wow. That brought great freedom to say, you know what, there's a number of ways we can accomplish it. This is the common goal. So understanding that conflict isn't just because I don't like you. Conflict emerges sometimes because we operate out of two different value points. And I may be arguing with somebody, never knowing that I'm actually arguing a value that I wasn't aware of. But it came out of that storming stage, able to identify it. And to come back to, here's how we do it. So, we've already talked about some values today. One of the values that I expressed is that there is greater value working together than working as individuals. That's a value. So, if you're determined to do it by yourself, somebody that wants to do it in a collective sense, those are two different value orientations. Another value that we've talked about today was multiplying ourselves. Like, I get a lot of joy in doing something, but that's not my primary value. I want to reproduce that passion that I have in somebody else. That's my greater value. That's why I want somebody to do it with me, so that can be reproduced in another person. Another leader can be trained. And so those values emerge, those positive values come out of that storming stage. And so that's a critical piece, not just for a small team, but it's also a critical piece for a large team, church. What are the values that our church is going to be known for? What are the values that we're going to minister out of? And as you start to drill down on that, that becomes very clear. Let's just finish this up and then we're going to break for lunch. Then there's the performing stage. So we've had the forming, coming together. We've had the storming, where we are jockeying, getting to know each other and to work through all those realities of bringing people into proximity. We've gone through the norming stage, where we've come out of storming. We're beginning to normalize now. We have identity. We have clear purpose. We understand the values we're functioning off of. Now we move into that performing stage. Work in progress commence with relatively stable cohesion. We move forward in unity. We're moving toward our goals. We own them. We share them. We know them. And we work toward completion. Action and results are easily identified, and we interact with it. It's not a taboo thing. I'm not intimidated if asked about the results of the task that I've been entrusted with. There's productivity. We're able to see that the ball has been moved down the field in terms of that which we were charged to see accomplished. So, again, there is a strong sense of cohesion and identity and joy of serving together. It is difficult to perform if those that I'm with, I don't love. And that I'm grateful to be doing this task together with. Last stage, adjourning. It's the completion and ultimately then disengagement of the task. We celebrate the accomplishment that has been done. There could be mourning in this stage. There could be a sense of loss. That team of seven of us, that team today is all now different. The single woman, she ultimately met a guy and got married. She moved to Canada. Marcia and I were asked out of that team. We went and we were regional director couple for the region. Another couple out of that team was asked to be a regional leader couple for Canada. And so that team in and of itself dispersed. And there was a sense of mourning over that because we were close colleagues as we did the task. But it's a completion and disengagement. The adjourning part is good to look at because some ministries actually have to have closure. Some teams have to actually say, okay, we've done the task. We've accomplished our purpose and our goals and our reasons for that. And sometimes things will continue simply out of tradition. So when somebody is asked, well, why do you do what you do? I don't know, I just do it. We come back to that first cause question, what's our purpose? What do I do? And so there is this part, and it can be a part that is a celebratory part. It's that part that we rejoice, it's been finished, let's bring this to closure, as then we reallocate resources to the next step that the Lord has. Okay, five views of team development. The forming, storming, the norming, the performing, and then the adjourning when we've completed that task. All right, it's the time for lunch, so let's just hit the pause button, and then Pastor will come and give us instructions, and we'll meet after lunch for the second part. Okay.
Chew on while you're chewing at lunch. Okay, let's go. And then I don't know how they got set up out there, but just don't fight over the donuts. Okay. That's right. Father, we thank you for your instruction this morning. We thank you for loving us and caring about us and desiring for us as a church to move forward as a team. Now I thank you, Lord, for those who prepare the lunch. I ask that you would use it to strengthen our bodies and equip us for this afternoon. We pray this in Jesus' name.
And so we created a separate time to get together. And what that person said was, he said, your personality is strong and my personality is a little more quiet. And I just, by the way I'm wired, I just won't be pushy. And I won't really get out what I'm saying. And if you are not patient and ask me a question and just wait and really get it from me, it's not going to come out. And I couldn't get over how it was a blind spot for me. I didn't see it. But it took courage for that person not to do a put down, but to actually say, I don't feel safe, let's find time, let's talk this through so that those things don't go on. Now we're going to talk here a little bit about a feedback loop as leadership so that we know what people think. Yes.
There's also that trouble that you ask a question and you might ask it numerous times and nothing is ever answered. So you stop asking and you stop giving your opinion or seeking the information because nothing was ever there.
ever there and ever done.
Nothing was ever heard, nothing was ever done, nothing was ever, again, I guess it goes back to that communication, nothing was ever done. So you just thought, well, I tried once, I tried five times, I tried 10 times, nothing was ever done.
To give feedback.
So why am I even bothering? So then you start to shut down.
Sure. So one of the things that may keep you going at that is that you know there's something underneath. You can't get it to surface yet, but you know there's something there. I mean, if there's something that in your spirit is just bearing witness, you know, we seem something just, we're not running all cylinders. I mean, it's just a gut feeling you have. And it's trying to find the environment where that can surface. I had it with one person. This person was the sweetest person I knew. She never said a negative thing. I mean, she was just a natural affirmer. So I knew there was a problem. And so I asked her and her husband, okay, give me some feedback on this problem. Oh, everything's good, and we're happy with this, so and so with that. I wrote her, and I said, could you just tell me what you think? And she wrote me back a 3-page answer. And there wasn't any hesitancy for her to express what she felt. And what I learned was, the way she was raised, you just do not tell leadership something bad. You just don't do that. That was the way she was raised. But given the opportunity to write it, for her, it diffused it. And I could put down my thoughts in writing. And I didn't even think of that for a while. But it provided the feedback avenue that she actually felt comfortable with. Because there was something under there. And I knew that kind of nice answer wasn't getting me past the issue.
We're also taught with the Bible, we're not supposed to be grumbling about things. And then if you feel that you're grumbling, then then you feel awful yourself because you actually spoke up and you were grumbling. And usually when people do speak up about things, and you're talking, you are grumbling because there's an issue.
Sure. So is there another way to frame processing a problem without a sense of grumbling? I mean, could we as a team of leaders, is there an environment that we can surface a challenging issue and I not just be perceived as a negative person because this is something that identifies an issue that we should address? Is that possible? So, I mean, we communicate a value. Well, if you do this, you're a complainer. Sometimes we feel the value. If I do this, I'm a complainer. But have we created a place of safety where that we can have a decision? I know my heart's right. I'm not living in sin. I'm not living in rebellion. The Lord promises that he's going to lead me in peace. So, like, I've processed my heart. You know, I'm not just coming as somebody I want to fly off the handle. But can we have a context where those expressions and views can be voiced? I don't know if that responds to what you're thinking of.
Yeah, I think you can. I guess it's still the way everybody will perceive maybe what you're trying to say, or...
I think when you're looking for an answer like that, too, the chain of command that we went through earlier, if you're going through those, right?
There is, but I'm thinking when you've tried numerous times to get to where you want to go and you're not getting there, the frustration level rises. And I think initially it isn't the grumbling, it's I need a solution, I need help, can you help me with this? Then as each time it's not dealt with and you're not, then it does, it kind of elevates.
It does snowball.
You get to that frustration point where, oh, come on! And then that's when you feel like you're grumbling, and you are. You're getting, it is. The situation has elevated that.
Are you referring to your team, or are you referring to the bigger team?
I'm referring to both. I think I'm referring that when you try to communicate something and your communication is not heard as many times as you've tried it, and if you're going from not just your team, but you need to get some answers from a higher authority or whoever's above you on the chart, and still it's not being heard, or then the frustration just kicks in and you think, okay, what I think, let me tell you what I think, because maybe other people feel this way too, but if no one hears it, then I start feeling I'm not worth it to be heard.
Sure.
And then that just sets in a whole bunch of other issues, and I know that's me and that's my personality, but I know that I'm not the only one who would feel that way. And when you start feeling that you're not worth it, or you're not valued, or this, it's just a whole nother ball game. And then the communication, it's just broadened. It's just gone into another area.
So for us to live out values of that, these are important things, that sense of how I'm feeling, it has got to be addressed. And it could be an issue where it's just an impassable issue, but at least someone can say, you know what, this was an honest discussion, and we wrestled through it. We may end up at different points, but to have a value as a group that just not being heard, or let's put it the positive, to be heard, is going to be a value that we're going to try and live by in our community. Let's look at this one here on accepted leadership. Again, we're in the context of teaming. Are we clear about who is the leader in given situations or on what issues? Are we clear about the role of the leader? Remember, in that storming stage, there can be a little bit of competition that goes on as you sort this through. Sometimes it's natural. Sometimes it's, wills being exerted. And this does function differently if it's guys, if it's just women, or if it's guys and women. It does work out different if on your team. And I think all of us have been in situations where we've just seen that play itself out. Does our team leader effectively facilitate the execution of key team processes, such as meetings, problem solving, planning, decision making? So this is one of those responsibilities that we would want to articulate, you know, in a job description that we're giving to a team leader. Are we effective team members? Are we proactive, taking initiatives and supporting the team leader? So on a team, those two sets of responsibilities, leadership, team leadership, as well as team membership, both have responsibilities in them. Mutual accountability. Individual and joint accountability for the team's purpose, goals, approach, and work product. So again, we're just unpacking that definition. Can you measure progress against specific goals? Do all members feel responsible for all those measures? One of the things that often will surface is that, and it usually is an indication of the health of a group, is when group members or team members will say, well, the team decided this, but I think this. Or the board decided this, but I as a board member really thought this. Or the elders did this, but I as an elder thought we should do that. One of the things, when you are functioning on a team, you do have one voice. in the context of that meeting, you have many voices as you are working through the issue. But once you have reached consensus, once you have reached that decision, you have one voice. So the elders don't speak as I'm one-fifth of the elders. No, the elders speak as the elders, and the board as the board. And those points where we might have been on different pages, they remain within the context of that team, within the context of that meeting. And it is a huge piece in the unity of it. Now, there may be some things that really is, and let's say it surfaces to the point where it really goes beyond what I'm comfortable with. Well, that person would excuse themselves from the team. Because we would own those things. We feel responsible for the choices and decisions that we make. And hopefully, though, as we move through that storming stage, we're coming to this sense of community in this area of accountability. Are members clear on what they are individually responsible for and what they are jointly responsible for? Is there that sense that only the team can fail, which comes back to that larger reality of that identity of the group we're working with? One of the challenges that comes in the teaming piece is this empowering. And we're moving into the subject of delegating responsibility. So, all of us, or maybe a good number of us, have been in situations where we have said yes to doing something because we were asked, but it wasn't long until all of a sudden we say, I'm just so tired. Nobody is supporting me. I'm doing all this on my own. That weight of what we've said yes to fell right on our shoulders. So it surfaces the question, well, why didn't I, in this responsibility that I've been given, why wouldn't I empower others in this, in terms of multiplying myself, recruiting others in this task? Sometimes we wrestle with, I think I can do it better. That's why I don't empower anybody else. Sometimes I'm afraid the other person will fail, so I don't ask them to do it. I may really enjoy doing this task, or maybe there's just no time. Get it done. I gotta do it. I don't want to seem unwilling to serve, so I don't want to ask somebody else to do it. It may look like I didn't want to do it. I want the credit, so I'm actually going to do the whole thing myself. I don't want to appear idle. But now here is some hesitations, though, when we drill down on what looks like possible surface responses to that. Am I dealing with insecurity? Do I have a lack of confidence in others? Do I lack the ability to train others? Maybe I've got a passion to do that, I just don't have the ability to do it. I've never been trained and coached myself. I've just had to learn it as I go. But what if I was in an environment where I was empowered to do my job, and I took what I was empowered to do and I re-empowered somebody else just like I was? Maybe I have a reluctance to do anything with other people because of past failures. I tried and it went bad. So there are, you know, when we hit this question about am I reproducing myself in others? Am I inviting others into this? Do I have a tendency to, when asked to do something, I just do it all myself? To run through these kind of issues, just to, Holy Spirit, what's going on inside me? Now, this is a good series of questions in terms of personal introspection. It's not so great if somebody runs up to you and says, oh, you're insecure. That feedback is sometimes kind of painful. But I've also found that when I invite somebody into the conversation with something that I'm wrestling with, I've often found I come away much better. When I open up, then I'm struggling with it, and I can't do it. Somebody that you trust really can't give you good feedback. There are four levels of delegation. And understanding these four levels was really helpful to me once I understood it. Because as a leader, I thought, hey, the idea of multiplying was, hey, just get somebody else involved. That's the number one thing. Or get others to participate in the task. That's the bigger thing. The problem was, I as a leader, I was still being called into a bigger meeting to give an accountability for the results. Did we get the task done? And so that thing of just getting other people involved and getting people to participate ended up being a frustrating thing. So I looked into this issue on delegating. And there are actually four levels surfaced. In delegating, you can do a level one delegation, which is, would you just do what I've asked you to do? Don't deviate from the instructions. I've already researched the options and I've determined what has to be done. This without a context, this without a relationship can be a pretty smug, can be a very pointed directive. But there are many times where this is simply, would you just do this? I need you to go down, you need to buy this for me at Staples. And then I need it back here by 2:00. That's pretty straightforward delegation. What might be another example of this type of delegation that comes to your mind?
Teach this lesson?
This way.
This way, yeah, okay.
It has to be this way.
Like a substitute teacher type of thing?
Yeah, or here's the material, I did the research, you do pizza.
Okay, so here's the lesson plan, go ahead and teach it, okay? Any other examples?
The kitchen for...
Okay. You know, if I go to a garage, I don't want somebody to deviate from the instructions and doing my brakes. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the brakes are supposed to be done, just do that. And I'm going to be really happy. Because that's going to give me confidence. I thought I would explore doing your brakes. And instead of putting two pads on, I thought I'd just try one. No, the book said put two on. So, I mean, even though it sounds kind of almost right there, there are a lot of contexts where this is simply a level of delegation. Level one delegation. A level two delegation, though, is researching the topic and report back. We will discuss it, and then I will make the decision and let you know what needs to be done. So you may be working with others, and you just have to incorporate other people to get the data you need. You have to get the research in. You have to get the information. We're going to do a church survey. So let's do this. Let's gather the information and let's bring it back to the collective body or to the collective person. And then once that information is there, that person will make a decision. All right, a level two. A level three type of delegation is here's the task, outline the options, and make a recommendation. So somebody is asked to, we want to expand, we want to go to a fourth level expansion of our church. All right, do the research on that. Here's what the costs are going to be. You're going to interact with a couple of different committees. You're going to outline some options. And then you're going to come back to leadership and say, here's what I found out, here's my recommendation. Consultants do that all the time. So they look at the data, make a presentation, here's a recommendation. This is a great level of delegation because when you get the feedback of what a person thinks, that's really a lot of insight. Because that person has done the work. And based on that, they're saying, so here's a recommendation. And you've got something to wrestle with. Level four delegation. This is when a person is told to make the decision and then tell me as a leader what you did. I trust you to do the work. I trust you in the decision. And I trust you in the execution of the decision. Simply report back to me how it went. That's a level four delegation. So the whole point of the four levels is that given the context of the responsibility, there's different ways in which it can be delegated out. If I'm working with a 13-year-old, depending on the issue, I may go with a level two delegation of that 13-year-old. If I'm working with a committee, they are fully empowered. That job description is well written. They've got their budget. That committee is running like a well-oiled machine. All we do is receive back the report. So there are different levels of delegation on this. The tricky part can be in delegation is how do we carry it out? Because even the statement here, I trust you. Now, does that imply that level one, two, and three, there's no trust? Does it imply that? It might appear as if it's there, but some of those issues may be so weighty on the person. They carry a reality to it that we just need to work it this way, and there has to be understanding. But in a vacuum, if those relationships are not healthy, this delegation really comes unglued. Oh, if you're not letting me just to run everything, you don't trust me. Well, that may not be the only issue. How about some feedback? What have been your experiences on this delegation matter? Has that been something that you as a leader have seen go well? You as a leader, you've seen it as a challenge?
I think it changes as your committee matures. As you begin with the committee, you often need to go into that step of one, two, three. But then as you see the leadership mature in their role with a defined position, there's nothing more empowering as the leader or as the committee person to be able to say, hey, this is your job. I'm here to help you, but please run with it. And then there's nothing better happens when they run with it and do a great job.
See, I know for myself, when I was working through the delegation, the asking and getting other people involved was the easy part for me. But where I was getting uncomfortable, I didn't create a feedback loop. I didn't create a loop to touch base. Just give me a call back once a week. Let's just touch base on how it's going. And once I identified that, it just reduced the tension for me. Let's just talk. Give me an update on how things are going. I didn't want to interfere. I didn't tell them what to do, but I had a communication coming back to me that was giving me some feedback. You know, things are going really well. Hey, you know, when this happened, we got to the church and there was no lights, the building was locked, we couldn't do it, we're really frustrated. So just to have something coming back to know, okay, here's how this is going as you're being entrusted with it. And so that helped me out in that. And as you look at the responsibilities you have, as you work with others, maybe that piece of creating that communication link, that feedback loop, it is a tremendous trust builder as you go down the road. Any other thoughts on the delegation part?
Don't you have to consider the abilities of those that you're delegating to? I mean, like, you wouldn't, somebody that can't do any research, you wouldn't tell them give them some assignment to research, or you wouldn't, I wouldn't ask my wife to maintain my truck. You know, she doesn't even like putting gas in it. But it's because you don't want to set them up for failure.
Sure. Okay, case in point. Yesterday, we have this car, and every 2 days I have to put air in the front left tire and the right rear tire. Every 2 days. I've even got an air compressor because I keep losing air. Well, after 6 months of doing this, I know, just ignore that statement. After 6 months of doing that, I said, we need to take it to a car shop and look at the tires. Marcia said, I'll do it. I said, that's great, because I don't have the time. Problem is, Marcia doesn't want to take the car to the car shop because maybe I'm going to get taken advantage of, maybe somebody's going to tell me you have to buy two new tires. So we just talked through what's going to happen. I said, when you go there, you're going to ask them to check and see, tell them this, have them look for a leak. Most likely, this is the problem. It'll probably cost about this much. If you have any problem different than this, call me. She went and did it, never called me, came back. It went just like that. It was delegated. So that's an example where there might not have been real high capacity in the knowledge of cars and tires, but somebody was very open in terms of, I got the information I needed to do the job that was entrusted to me, and I could do it. And if I got in over my head, here's a safety belt. Because I think that's an important way to look at it, particularly if you're on the front end of coaching, if you're on the front end of enabling others. Because if you're enabling others that have minimal experience in what you're doing, you're going to be higher up on the coaching piece as you would do that.
What if you, I'm thinking about what you just said with Marcia. Now, Marcia's an adult, and maybe she didn't know a lot about cars. But sometimes when you're delegating, it could be in a teaching role where you want to give them a responsibility to learn something. And it's just like the parents when your kids were in school, you didn't want them to fail. So many times, well, let me do your project for you, or I'll do half of it, or I'll do this or this. So what do? Do you delegate, let the person fail, let them maybe see what that, not exactly even fail, it's not even a pass-fail kind of thing, but maybe let them see what maybe could have been improved and go through that process, or do you stop it before it even gets there and make changes?
Intervention, okay.
And say, okay, we're not going to let you get to that point, I'm just going to take over and I'm going to do this.
Okay. Real great question. Any feedback on this question? Great question.
I'll feedback.
Wait a second, you asked the question.
No, but I'm thinking of the person on the other side of it now, that if I was asked to do something, and I know it's tough to fail, but if, again, here's the thing, that if you take something, and if somebody would continually, and I told Danny, don't think that I'm asking this question because of you, but sometimes if you take it upon yourself then to change things or correct things, and it's not in the right kind of attitude, then that person starts to feel what I did wasn't good enough. I don't think I want to do it again because I don't want to have that kind of feeling.
Sure.
So then you don't do it. You back out.
Sure. Yeah, so obviously, there's that situation of, yes, I can learn through failure if I'm a teachable person. If you're not teachable, even failure doesn't necessarily speak into your life. I think particularly when we're engaging young people and when we're engaging millennials, We've got to believe that, that failure is not the only educator. You know, we just have to believe that. Because we really do want to work for somebody's success, and we want them to do well. And there will be times when we've got to look at ourselves. One thing that I will trip over a lot is I needed to get somebody to do the job, and I got them, and I thought that was actually the deal. But actually, that was only part of the deal. The other part of the deal was then empowering them, enabling them so they could succeed in what I asked them to do. And I didn't put that time in. And so that person tanking in that responsibility, I saw that as me as a leader, because I hadn't actually invested what was needed in that person. So I agree with you. I think there's the two sides of it. If there is that one thing where, you know, you really have to touch the stove before you know it's hot, there's that type of learner. But there's the other side too, which is, all right, if I have recruited somebody but not invested into them for the success, that I think is the weight that falls on me as the leader. And I may have either not allotted the appropriate time, I may not have been that close with the person. I may have over-assumed their skills, and it went bad. Mm-hmm. So on those initial goes, you know, we're going to make some of those corrections in that.
I think there's a lot more positives to delegation than negatives. One of the things that I see is this, you can be an esteem builder. You can help that person that doesn't think they're capable, but you can help build their self-esteem by delegating something for them to do that might be small, but yet they never would have done it unless asked or to be involved in it.
That's the empowerment component.
Yeah.
You're empowering them to do something.
Yeah. That really is a great example. What's the name of the movie that they always show at Christmas time? The Jimmy Stewart movie?
It's a Wonderful Life.
It's a Wonderful Life. What was he delegated to do that put him on the tailspin? Wasn't he supposed to get the money to the bank?
His uncle was.
And that, something went wrong in that process. I know I should have this movie memorized, but, you know.
Oh,
but
a little boy.
That delegating, and you're right, when we delegate, it is married to trust. And that's what we're trying to build. We're trying to build trust. We're trying to earn trust. We're trying to develop trust. And we know that Scripture talks about that which is entrusted with little, which is entrusted with much. So we know that there is a variance in this issue. But we are wanting to develop trust. And probably an area which is difficult for established churches is entrusting and delegating to a younger generation. That is not easy. But again, is our value, we do it as our generation, do we hold that tight? Or when we die, we can say there's another generation that's been trained now and steps in. In fact, they don't even wait till we pass on, because we've been investing in them as they go. Trust builders. We're along this line already in our thought. Transparency and vulnerability with others builds trust and loyalty. This is actually documented. In this book here, Teams That Thrive, it's co-authored by Warren Bird, a CMA guy up at the Alliance Seminary, actually documented results on this, that transparency and vulnerability with us builds trust and loyalty. If I would say in the last 5 years, the way my leadership is shifting is on this whole point right here. If you would ask my dad how do you lead? He says, he would probably tell you, I was taught to lead, you kept the armor polished right, you didn't air laundry, and you didn't show weakness. But today's generation, that doesn't go. That doesn't go. And so when you talk about building trust with transparency and vulnerability, most people say, you gotta be kidding me. I mean, vulnerability? That means you know my weaknesses? You know what I'm embarrassed about? You know what I don't do well? It actually builds trust. Leaders feel that they have to provide the right answers. Have you felt that pressure? Leaders feel the need to project they don't make mistakes. You know, if these are the two values that we operate from as leaders, we are going to get pushed in a corner quicker than we think. Because the issues that we deal with, whether it's in our home, whether it's in our marriage, whether it's in the tasks that we have at the church, we realize quickly, I don't have the right answers. And I make mistakes. Here's three fears that challenge us in this whole area of building trust. We fear, particularly in the context of the church, that we're going to lose somebody. Somebody's going to leave. So, we just let people be the way they are. We let people have their own way. We better do what they want. All of a sudden, we're using this us and them terminology because we have a fear. We don't want somebody to be disgruntled and leave. We have another fear. We have a fear of a leader of being embarrassed. I don't want to be embarrassed. I don't want to look dumb. I don't want to look incapable. But this fear of being embarrassed, I mean, that's a reality. But we have to look at the flip side of it. Where is that rooted? And often for us men, it's rooted in our pride. I don't want anybody looking over my shoulder. I'm happy when you give me a job and just let me do it. Don't ask me how it went. Don't ask me what I spent on that. Don't ask me how long it took me. Just let me do it. Wait a second. If I don't want to be embarrassed, sometimes I'll hold back my ideas. You know, I thought about this, but it sounded like such a dumb idea. I didn't want somebody to say that. Or the other end of, I don't want to be embarrassed, so I cover up my mistakes. When it doesn't go well, I cover it up. And I don't even admit it. That's all rooted in a fear. And fear-based leadership is not the value we want in leadership. A third fear. I have a fear of feeling inferior. And that also is rooted in the ego. I want to feel important. I want to preserve my social standing in the eyes of others. That's why, I mean, we have expressions we put on air. You know, what will they think? So when we wrestle with some of this stuff, we're also dealing with, okay, what are the things that God is at work in my own life? We're in that sanctifying process. Paul talks about the already. I am already a new creation in Christ. But I have still one foot in Adam and one foot in Christ until I'm in heaven. There is that working out of my salvation until I stand before the throne of grace. And so there are these issues that we will continue to work through. And so when we work with others, we know that others wrestle with this fear of being embarrassed, this fear of being inferior. But we don't want these feelings to be dominating a person. For the believer in Christ, we have the privilege to have Christ come in and make those changes. So, potential solutions as we enter the danger zone. We engage. And leaders, if we're gonna lead well, we will learn to speak the truth in love. And that's not just saying it needs to be said, so I'm saying it. Because there's sometimes a person that's going to hear that cannot hear it right then. They are not there. And we've got to seek the Lord, seek the opportunities that He is going to enable so that that conversation can happen in His time. I have had conversations with people where it was the right thing to say. It was just at the wrong time. I didn't sense the Holy Spirit. I thought I couldn't be patient. It couldn't wait any longer. But actually it could. It could have been just with that person, not in front of a group. Oh my goodness. So we engage the danger zone, we speak the truth in love, we express concern to help others, and we actually move out beyond protecting ourselves. And sometimes things that are said within that team setting, in that relational setting, we say it reactively because we're responding out of personal offense. We're responding out of we got our toes stepped on. And so now I'm in this real awkward place where I'm not leading, but I'm actually reacting. This solution, though, I put this up because I really believe this is what we've got to do. We've got to engage a situation. We can't pull back from people. We can't pretend like things aren't happening. But if we are not... if we have not bathed those discussions in prayer, if we have not sought the Holy Spirit for His timing and even the very words that we communicate, they end up just being painful encounters. And the speaking the truth in love, I think that is part of our leadership journey that we can actually practice together and learn how to do this. Because even though we are followers of Jesus, we do have to practice how we do this. And all of us has a story to tell in this area. Can anybody do this? No. Yes. I mean, to get into the danger zone, to get close into those crucial conversations, to those uncomfortable conversations, it takes that spirit-filled, bathed person to enter that. If your self-esteem is low, you end up being more defensive. You end up being more reactive. Are you able to let go of ego and fear? I had no idea as a man how much ego impacted me. How much fear impacted me. You can't be afraid if you're a man. Well, what do I do with my fear then if I can't be afraid when I am afraid? I've got to be humble. Courage. Holy Spirit, wisdom, and discernment. So, I want to close with this. A guy named Jay Desko, and I actually brought one copy of this document. I'll give it to Pastor, and I think it would be helpful even to give it to your various leaders, team leaders that are here today. But he deals with this issue of developing trust as a team. And actually, everything moves off of this trust and the Holy Spirit. He says, just like in your car, you've got those gauges that you look at. He said, in relationship of building trust, there are six gauges that will help you build trust. Character, communication, connectedness, concern, competence, and consistency. These six areas are trust-building gauges for us as leaders. So let's just look at those real quick. Character. Character refers to a person's intrinsic value system and external actions. So areas often associated with character are honesty, fairness, hard work. So meaning, my character, what I say and what I do, that gap is as narrow as it can be. Because somebody is going to pick that up right away. He says this, but he acts this way. She said this, but she does that. Character is that quality that builds trust in other people. When I know, as somebody that's going to follow you, when I know that what you say, you will do, that builds trust. That builds trust. Another gauge, communication. Trust is facilitated by communication between people and groups. Sending clear messages and listening are the two primary mechanisms for effective communication. So, do we communicate clearly? Are we listening well? If we do those two sides of communication, it builds trust with people. Connectedness. Relationships play a vital role in building and maintaining trust. When people are relationally connected to one another, they have a greater opportunity to know what's happening in the lives of others, to manifest care and concern when needs are discovered, and to keep potential for conflict and misunderstanding to a minimum. So that connectedness, how well are we connected with each other? That's a trust gauge. So when I'm familiar with you, when I see you, when I sit with you, when I'm in your home, when you're in my home, when we go fishing together, when we go shopping together, when we create a connectedness, when we pray together, when we study the Word together, when we have coffee together, that builds a connectedness. And there's an opportunity for us to care for each other. And when something surfaces, there's a context that that can be addressed. Another gauge, the gauge of concern. Again, we're looking at the six areas that build trust. People have confidence and trust those they perceive to show authentic concern for them. Leadership has the task to manifest concern in three primary areas: concern for self, concern for other members, and concern for the overall health of the organization. You know, we have all met people. Hi, welcome to my church. And he's looking at the next guy coming in the door after he's shaking your hand. I mean, they're just it didn't happen. We've had people talk with us, should know us, and there's not that sense of authentic concern. I build trust with people that I feel care for me, that are concerned for my well-being. So, for leadership, concern for yourself. That's not a bad thing, to be aware of how we conduct ourselves, how we treat ourselves. Do I eat right? Do I sleep well? The other aspects of self-care that are healthy for a leader. Concern for other members on my team, and then the larger organization. And then the gauge of competence. Competence is primarily concerned with an individual's capacity to perform a task or a role with an acceptable level of proficiency. So that builds trust. So if somebody, and you know, you may have formed a team and you're doing the task, but as time goes on, you don't always hit it right. It's not, we don't automatically get the right fit. And sometimes it just, it's not there. And so we have to create a realignment. And we do that gently and gracefully. But for us as leaders, we are looking at what has been entrusted to us. We are accomplishing that task with a good level of proficiency. So if I don't understand my task, there's no way I'm going to hit the bar of proficiency. That's why we start to see how these pieces start to come together. Be a leader that's aware of how others perceive you. The feedback loop is important. And how do you get feedback as a leader? And just asking somebody, what do you think? How did that meeting go? How did that event go that we did together? Just that simple question is a question that opens the door and says that you're approachable to get that feedback. And solicit feedback from others. The thing here on this feedback issue, start with people that you trust. Start with people that you trust. Because not all people really know how to give feedback well. I mean, giving good feedback, it's something that you learn to do. So go to somebody that you trust in case there's a bit of an edge to the feedback. Better the wounds of a close friend. So that you can talk that through. But this feedback, so many leaders don't have a feedback loop. And as we all have blind spots, every one of us has blind spots. No matter what our gifts and our skills are, we have those blind spots. And the feedback helps keep us on a learner track as we go through this. All right, six gauges, feedback, as you have heard these. Do any of those trust gauges in particular hit you really strong? Like, this is a big one for me. Any of those six stand out more so than the others? Say that again.
Consistency. There should be one more.
Oh, did I have one more than
yeah.
I?
Mm-hmm.
Be consistent and do the whole thing.
Consistency. Be consistent and give all of them. All right. Consistency. People tend to trust others that show predictability or consistency. Unpredictability in a person, we're less likely to trust them. Now, that may be challenging for somebody that enjoys spontaneity. That may be challenging for somebody that likes to do things just on the cuff. But as a leader, as you're looking to build trust, realize that predictability creates trust in others. None of us are 100% consistent. We must regularly assess if we're consistent enough in our words, actions, and performance to ensure a reasonable level of trust. You as a leader, your number one job to hear from the Lord, yes, but your number one task is to build the trust of those you're leading. Because people will follow, people will engage, people have joy serving with those they trust. So as you have been given your places of leadership, try not to rely on the fact that you have positional leadership. I'm the head of this, or I'm in charge of that. And do what I say because of it. But actually frame what you're doing as that stewardship. That which you've been entrusted with. And then earn the trust of those that you are leading. And there is great delight in serving together with and following those that we trust. That's just a great thing. And the joy of serving as a team is that you know you have others that know about what you're doing. You have others that are there when you need help. You have others that have your back when you're going into a difficult situation. The joys of serving as a team are many. But the stages, we can't bypass them. And so I want to just applaud you as I wrap up my section of your event today. I want to applaud you for giving of your Saturday to invest into this issue of leadership. Because you've been entrusted with a great thing. And the ability to influence people for the kingdom of God. There's not a greater thing that we can invest our lives in. And the task which you are doing, may you be found faithful in those responsibilities. And may you delight in reproducing that which God has put in your heart into the hearts of others. And may trust flow between the relationships you have with those that you work with. It will make you a distinctive people when we live this way. And there will be those that see it and they'll want to be a part of what you're doing. Well, you still have a good agenda for this afternoon, and I just want to thank you for the part that you've given me. I look forward to ongoing interaction that we'll get to have and the joy of getting to know each other better. But can I just close our section in prayer and ask the Lord's blessing over you? Lord, thank you so much. Thank you so much for what you have done and you are doing in our lives. And Lord, we just realize that even in our journey with you, you continue to lead us further, saying to us, do you trust me? I am good. Do you trust me? Lord, we realize that we are broken people. We live in a broken world. So many of the situations that we live and work in are broken themselves. And it's so easy for that to influence us. But Lord, you have come into our life. You have given us the Holy Spirit to lead us and to guide us in Christ-likeness and godliness. So Lord, as we have invested ourselves into the things of this day, would you just separate out from all of it that which is not of you? But Lord, seal deeply into our heart that which you want us to hear. And Lord, as we process this information in the days and weeks ahead, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Give us grace, not only with ourselves, but with others. So that we will be the people of God, the church of God, in this context where you've placed us, that we'll be able to be used by you to bring others into the journey that you yourself have called us into and put us on. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Can you thank Dave? No. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate you coming all the way from Hollidaysburg, and trust that you live closer.
Thank you.
Marcia, what did they have to do to those tires?
They just had, they had, we had run over something, so they had nails in them.
Really? I guess they nailed them.
After 6 months.
He's gone up to make some copies, but she'll be back. She doesn't need. I asked Nancy Depp if she would just give some instruction on some of the papers that are in your folder concerning visitor background checks, all that kind of stuff. If volunteers, she can give you more information on that. I relinquish the chair.
Here at our church, we have a volunteer personnel form, and it is mostly used exclusively in disciple-making ministries, but it is applicable to every area of ministry. And so we just wanted to give some clarification to that as leaders of a particular committee, it is your responsibility as new workers come into your committee that you have them complete this volunteer personnel form. It is not exclusive to those that are just serving with children or youth. The volunteer form is inclusive of everyone that is serving. There are a certain portion of it, there's a certain portion of it that is exclusive for children and youth, but in general, everyone would complete the volunteer personnel form. You find that after the calendar pages. It was recently updated, and it complies with all of the Pennsylvania state laws that would only be applicable for those that are serving with youth and children. The exception to that is to our elders. They also would complete the clearance part of that as well, because they would have opportunity to disciple children, youth, and adults. That is also applicable for any small group leader or Sunday school teacher where a team would be attending their class. So currently we don't have that happening, but if there are teens that attend an adult Sunday school class or an adult small group, then that teacher must have their clearances on file as well. So I have a procedure sheet that would be applicable for all ministry leaders pertaining to that, and I'm going to ask Pastor if we'll pass these around. This is an example for you, and as a committee chairman, you would need to write your own procedure sheet. This is just an example. This is what Disciple Making Ministries is going to be doing to complete our role in seeing that the volunteer personnel forms are done. So while he's passing that around, one of our ongoing things in every one of our departments is to have recruitment happening and enabling other workers to come alongside of us. What we are suggesting in the Disciple Making Ministries is to not utilize a person that's already overly involved in two or more other ministries within the church. And then to be sure as committee members that we are advising them of the following procedure to follow. If a person is already serving in another church ministry, it can be assumed that they are an already approved worker. Okay. That is obsolete as of today, unless you are already serving in another area of ministry. But we can't keep going back and saying, oh, by the way, you've served for 10 years, now fill out this form. Okay? So we can assume that if they are an approved worker, if they're already serving. If the person's new to the church, number three, please let them deepen their walk of faith for at least 6 months to 1 year of regular attendance. This would be true in disciple-making ministries. It may not be true in another area of ministry, such as the welcome committee. Maybe somebody faithfully attends for 6-8 weeks and they want to get involved. Just as an example, the welcome committee, the kitchen committee, those would be great places to involve them.
But in a teaching or leading role, we need to make sure that they're walking in their walk of faith to deepen themselves. And then here's where the procedure starts to be very defined for disciple-making ministries. Each committee leader would need to define it for their own ministry. Within disciple-making ministries, the person would be approached in this manner. We're recruiting people for children's ministry. Would you have an interest in serving there? So it's an unspecific approach. It does not say, serve in children's church for the next 4 weeks, okay? It's just an inquiry, all right? After you've made that inquiry as a leader, and if they, and once that's been said, yes, I'm interested, then number four, you would present their name to the Disciple-Making Ministries Committee for approval prior to approaching them with a defined area of service. You want to make sure that they are willing, but don't define the service. Disciple-Making Ministries Coordinator then submits those names to the Board of Ministries for approval in consultation with the pastor. And then number five, once they're approved, you go back and you approach that potential volunteer. And at that point, you should have all ministry information readily available for them, including a current schedule, ministry description, statement of faith, and the volunteer form. All of those things are in your book, being the statement of faith and current schedule. You would have that among your own committees. Ministry descriptions, Disciple-Making Ministries has just developed almost 30 descriptions and gotten them all approved in the last 3 months. And so you would take the description with them. So in other words, you want to have everything in hand, clear picture, as you're recruiting this person. And then also the flow chart, which is in our book. Encourage the potential worker to review the materials and pray how the Lord is leading them to serve. And then once you've received back another affirmative answer, request that the volunteer form that you have given them already be returned to you within 10 days as the ministry leader. So as the ministry leader, Nancy, children's ministry, Connie, youth, and Julie, adult, that form only goes back to them. Okay, so it goes back to them, and then they have additional responsibilities that they complete once the forms have come back to them, where they check the references and then make tabulations on those forms. The form should be in a file folder. Don't allow longer than 10 days if possible, because it just becomes an ongoing process. You will have some exceptions to that. If someone working with children or youth doesn't have current clearances, it's going to take them longer than 10 days to get their clearance, especially the FBI one. It's a longer check if that's applicable to them. And so you may have to extend that a little bit of time. What the Pennsylvania law states, this is on number 8, second part of it, Pennsylvania law states that the clearances are required to be within the past 60 months to be considered current, and do not accept out-of-date clearances because you're just going to have to go back to the person. There's a very up-to-date Excel file, and it lists the person's name by the date also of when their clearances will expire, and all of disciple-making ministries leadership has that file that is being kept, and that's kept up to date by the Board of Ministries designee, and that is Rich at this time, because Rich has done all of this for basketball. And so in an effort for us all to be working together, Board of Ministries appointed a designee to be the record keeper, and so that is Rich. So for disciple-making ministries, the forms come back to those three leaders. They check the references. They keep the forms in their box. Once everything is on file and in place, then they give it to me as the coordinator. I review it and check off on it, and then I pass that on to the head elder, and the head elder takes that to the governance authority for their final approval, and then that paperwork comes back to me, and all this is done through your office mailbox, and paperwork isn't just shifting around places. And then I pass that on to the Board of Ministries designee, that is Rich, and then he tabulates and files it. I know that's a lot of detail, and in each of your particular ministries, it would be a little bit different. It would be different for somebody in missions mobilizers, be something different for worship. So you'll want to take this document and adapt it to you, because in 99% of those cases, clearances won't be needed. But for children and youth workers and for our elders, they are needed.
Can you talk about worship and the volunteer personnel form?
Yes.
Is that anybody that would be coming into choir has to fill out one of these?
This will be anybody who's serving in leadership. That's up to the government's authority to determine how far that evolves. My recommendation would be worship team. Somebody's front and worship team, but someone in the choir. That would be up to the government's authority.
Hey, you did get a curriculum proposal form in your booklet too, so you can give your piece of curriculum. You have to fill that out, go through the process. So, all right. What'd you learn today? How many of you are leaders? Any wannabes? Yeah, some of that stuff you went over there, I kind of wonder what I'm doing up here. Okay. Well, you got a lot there to take home and digest and stuff. So you, all you leaders, you're supposed to get this stuff back to me so I can tabulate, look at it and everything else, okay? So on Leadership Day committee meeting, and each committee should have a flow chart, a yellow one, that I should get so I can kind of look at your...
Ours is black and white because we didn't see yellow, or we wrote something else on yellow.
Oh, okay. Well, if I can find it in there, we'll...
It's in there. It's
okay.
It's just black and white.
All right. The last thing I want to do today is go over looking at dates, because one of the things that happens from time to time is that we either double book or we get confused as to what is actually happening. And so in your notebook, you have... And by the way, Julie and Nancy were behind a lot of this stuff that goes on that's in your book and a lot of other stuff that went on getting everything organized. If you are a leader and you have people that weren't here tonight, there's a notebook form out there. So if you would make sure that they get that notebook, and shame, okay, for not being here. All right, make them feel bad. That's probably not a good thing to do. But I think they missed some good stuff. So this is February, and we do know that the basketball banquet is on March 5th, and the ladies' banquet's on May 13th, and sometime is Easter. So if you have dates that you want to put on there, first come, first serve.
Do you know if March 4th has been reserved for the community volleyball tournament?
I have nothing. No.
I think we've turned that down because the usual runs till about midnight.
That's right. The next day is the
basketball banquet.
So.
Mm-hmm. Be set up.
Yeah. Okay.
So if they want to have to do it a different time, I guess.
Monday, April 3rd is a tentative date for cravings.
April 3rd?
Yes. It's tentative. We need to confirm that Monday night, but I believe that's a tentative date.
Okay, and they're meeting on February the 13th, correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
Healing the heart.
Pardon?
Healing the heart on the
church on the 11th, that Saturday evening?
March 11th, yes. There will be two follow-up meetings for that one. One will be everybody's invited, and then the other one will be a, what do you call it?
Solemn assembly,
which will probably be on a Sunday night, I would think.
So we're having missions and healing the heart on the 11th?
Yes, the missions committee has met, and they're giving the missionaries that night off, correct, Rich?
That was what we were talking about.
That's what we decided, because we didn't have any other dates available for healing the heart the rest of that month that would work for Ken, particularly. March 18th is my mother's birthday party. When you get to be 90, you can have a birthday party too. So, actually, my sisters and brothers wanted to do it on the 11th, and I said no.
90.
Yeah. There's some Doris Grimes, if you want to.
We should all send her a card together. Heard
that. 11582 Fletcher Chapel Road. I lived there off and on for the last 16 years. I moved back home when I was 50, believe that. She was glad to have me.
What is it again?
11582. 11582. Yep. Fletcher. F-L-E-T-C-H-E-R. Chapel Road.
Yeah.
Medina?
Yeah.
Medina, New York. 14103? I think that's right. 14103.
That's New York? Where's Esther Leader?
Yeah, she's, yeah. Yeah, I think it's 14103.
And what's your mother's name?
Doris.
Doris?
Doris, D-O-R-I-S. Betty Stout Grimes, but Doris Grimes will work. G-R-I-M-E-S.
After famous George.
Yep.
Fairly coincidence.
It was gone.
Wow.
It was gone.
Yeah, it was gone.
No.
Bill's got dates they want to put on here.
14103, is that what you said?
Yes.
That's what it is.
It is. Oh, thanks.
Oh, hey, gosh, Terry, look at you on your phone.
I've lived so many places, I can't remember which.
My computer.
I don't know what this one is. Is it 17657 or?
15767.
Okay. No wonder I'll get email. Actually, it's all being forwarded from Clearfield.
And theirs is probably what you said first.
No, that one's 16830.
Oh,
yeah, I got that one down. I've lived there off and on for the last year.
Pastor, February 24th.
February 24th.
Missions are meeting to do all of the flag stuff for.
Missions meeting? What time is that?
Regular time, 1 o'clock.
1 o'clock.
Yep, we're going to be gathering to get all the flags ready and to get them up actually for the 26th.
Okay. Is that mission mobilization? Okay.
Can you clarify just something?
Sure.
We have some dates, but it's nothing that is here. Is this just for our facility calendar, or is this something that we want to put on the church calendar that Debbie prepares for?
That's what we want.
That's what we're doing here.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, then we can do
this. Okay, so that's what this is about.
Okay, okay, sorry, I was thinking it was facility-wise. Okay.
Well, it's not just for this building, it's
okay.
So that it goes out to church calendar, print up so that somebody say, oh, I didn't know that was happening. Okay.
The silver ring thing is March 18th.
Right.
From 7 to 9, doors open at 6:30 at the high school.
Okay.
April 28th through 30th is breakaway.
one of the deal breakers.
Oh, that's right, yeah, yes, never mind.
28th to the 30th?
Yeah, you can put it on the calendar.
Okay.
Our spring retreat, youth spring retreat is May 19th through 21st.
Spring retreat. Okay.
Your Brookway missions trip, if we get it approved, is June 30th to July 11th.
What is that? Connie, what was that?
Trip to Uruguay, missions trip to Uruguay.
Oh, when did that come up? Are the kids going?
Yeah.
Do you want to go?
Yeah.
Do you want to go? We would like to have an adult go.
We have two kids go.
Is the yard sale still the 5th and the 6th?
Yes. Yes.
You are U-G-U-A-Y. What was the first
you
letter?
You are U-G-U-A-Y.
Does
anybody want to go to Uruguay?
A-Y?
I will go next year.
This year.
You are U G A what?
No,
U-A-Y.
You are U G U.
I know who I am.
Who's on first?
Nervous.
Who's on second? I don't know.
Just U.
You are U.
G.
Yeah.
U.
U.
A.
A.
Y.
Give me a U. That's the 30th or the 11th. Okay. Wait, you said something. What was
the youth yard sale?
What is that?
The youth yard sale is on there. It's on the 4th and 5th of May.
In May.
May.
Okay, gotcha.
Bring your stuff. You want your stuff.
Got any more time?
No, not right now.
Okay.
That's just for a
while. Hopefully the trustees will have a couple days to put in here for a spring thing and stuff. I hope.
When's the 4th of July pick?
It's my understanding April 9th and April 16th. There's no Sunday evening ministers. That was from a while back.
April
9th, there's a dinner. Is that still current?
Oh yeah, that should probably be on there for having a fall Sunday dinner.
Which one's Easter?
Easter is the 16th.
Okay. So is there a cantata or is just a Easter?
Couple songs, right? Okay. Karen?
Easter, choir's doing two songs.
Okay. And the 9th is Sunday, right? Can we do a dinner?
I'm just asking.
There's turkey in the freezer, so I'd assume that's a go.
Okay. There's turkeys. Okay. And that's like it. So those two, right, there's no.
Yes.
Actually, I think it had on my.
So there's no Sunday.
That's it.
Okay. Nancy.
Yes.
Will King's Easter party be
church
April 2nd?
Church dinner on the 9th?
Yes.
So the 9th and the 16th, there is none. There's no evening service. Then the 23rd and the 30th. The 30th would be the last family night.
There's no evening services on March 5th or 12th as well.
That is correct.
The 5th is the basketball banquet, so there's no evening.
Right.
And the 12th is the last night of missions, so there's no King's Kids or small groups or stuff.
Well,
Rich, is there a dinner on the 12th?
That's 11, no Sunday.
Do we have them the missionary that night? They've been kind of slack. I'm trying to clear that.
Yeah, I just got the itinerary the other day. I think one of them has to leave Sunday afternoon. And then the other one, I think, is Monday morning.
That's usually how it works.
But we're sharing them with a happy.
Right. I have to check that